Hi everyone, and welcome back to Steering Mariners. Today, on very popular demand, I have with me again Captain Abhiranjan, whose last video was very well received and got a lot of questions from the viewers. And today I'm going to be asking him the questions that the viewers have asked him, and he's kindly agreed to join us on today's video and answer those questions. So Captain, welcome again.
Thank you again, Sam. It is always a pleasure to be in this platform and happy to answer anything which you ask.
Oh, thank you very much, Captain. So today we'll start with the first question is that been asked of you is that how is life on dynamic positioning vessels, DP vessels? How is life on the vessels for, let's say, if somebody's working as an AB or a crew or officers or deck officer or engine officer? Generally, how is the life on board in terms of shore leave or anything else that you can talk about? You know more about it, so I'll leave it to you.
Okay. So offshore vessels, dynamic positioning vessels, mostly you will find all kind of offshore vessels now towards dynamic positioning, platform support vessels, diving support vessels. So these, if it is a platform support vessel, it is a cargo ship. It is a mini cargo ship which supplies to oil platforms and rigs and to and fro back from the port to the oil rig. So the time and shore when they are in the port is comparatively less than the other project vessels like diving support vessels and pipe lay vessels or probably an anchor handler who are project based only. The life as such is this, that because they are in one port most of the time, like let's say, in for example, my vessel was in Abu Dhabi. So I used to always enter in same port again and again. So it is not that you will not be able to visit that port ever. Maybe you will not be able to visit it once, but at one instance, but there will be many chances you will get. While signing off and signing on also, you will get an opportunity to visit the port. Life on board as such is 12 hours of rota, of duty time. And then you have internet on board mostly. Otherwise, generally you are in signal area of your mobile network. So you can have internet, you have voice chats. Few oil majors do have this restriction though, that no camera phones are allowed. So, but things can be managed. So, you know,
it is like and that. And officer officer's life on board, like deck officers or engineer officers, junior ranks, what kind of watch hours do they have? And do they get an opportunity to go ashore as well?
So for officers, DP vessels are, DP vessels have two officers on the bridge all the time. Okay. And generally the master is for supervision. And for even the ratings, there are mostly, it's a buddy system always. So there are two people together. So loneliness doesn't come generally. And if it is a project ship like diving support ship or a pipe layer or something, then again, there are so many people around you that you will not get bored or you will not get lonely. There are also cinema rooms and other things. But after 12 hours of shift, you would probably want to watch a movie in your laptop, chat with your wife and go to sleep.
You know? Yeah. So, and Captain, what's the...
Contract is quick.
Yes,
so,
yes.
So the clock ticks the moment you come in. Right. In only 60 days, you probably go back home, or 30 days, you go back home.
Okay. So the contract is about 4 to 6 weeks. Is that right to assume? Is it that for everybody?
2 months on off is universal, but yes, few people have it 6 weeks also. Few people have 28 days on, 28 days off also.
Okay. And is that for officers and crew, everybody, engineers, decks, crew?
Yes, mostly. Yes.
All right. And of course, Captain, I don't know how much I can ask you about the salary, because I'm sure the salary in general, it will probably differ from company to company, isn't it? We can't give one answer about salaries there.
Correct. Correct. But a general rule, what I can give you a range of this thing. So ratings salary is quite comparable to main fleet. It is not that high. So the ratings come to offshore because only to have a better life, as in work and vacation break-wise. Then otherwise, the officers are probably a second mate in main fleet would earn around $6,000 or $7,000. Here he would be earning $200 per day. So that becomes again $6,000.
Okay, I see.
But if it is he's senior, so he could earn around $250 to $300 also. So that jump is there. So if it is he's earning $300, then he's earning $9,000, which is as good as a chief mate bulk carrier in in main.
Right. Captain, the next question that has been asked of you is that, are oil rigs part of offshore vessels? And if yes, then how is life on oil rigs?
See, this offshore field was the birth of this offshore industry was due to oil rigs and platforms. These are fixed structures. Rigs are on legs. Jack-up rigs are on legs. They can move around, but generally they are, once they are on the seabed, they are fixed on the seabed, then you know it takes a little time for them to complete their job there and move to another location. So they are fixed structures. This we have to keep in mind. And next, the life on board is similar. Only good thing is they don't get bad weather there. There is no rolling or pitching in that thing. Otherwise, but on the hindsight, they are subject to more risk because it is a high risk environment. Hydrocarbons are being pumped out, are being processed, and you know, so tankers are loading sometimes a little far away from that. So it is a high risk environment, and their jobs are fixed. You wouldn't hardly get any apprentice in oil rigs. So they would want to take good experienced officers, crew, rating, everybody. So hardly there are any apprentice in oil rigs. Otherwise, the life is same. 12 hours mostly and 28 days on off, up to 2 months on off. Depends on which country are you working in.
Right. And would you have any idea about the kind of salary that the people on oil rigs, they get? Is it very comparable to the DP vessels or what kind?
It is higher than the DP vessels.
Okay, higher than DP vessels.
Yeah, it is higher than the DP vessels. In oil rigs, there are no such second officer, third officer like that.
Right.
So a seaman or an AB would probably earn $500-$600 more. But if in rating somebody is interested in going, I would say to do few extra courses like lifting and handling of heavy lifts, crane operations and all that, rigging, slinging, all these courses. And whichever country they are going to apply, it should be ratified to that course and to go for that. Because their salaries are more. Just for an example, a crane operator salary in an oil rig is around $400 a day.
Oh, wow.
Where compared to a AB who is also a crane operator in a merchant ship is nothing extra.
Wow. Okay.
It's normal.
Right.
So,
right.
Things like that.
Yeah. So I just want to make it very clear, maybe if somebody didn't hear Captain correct properly, that he's saying that if you want to work on oil rigs, especially they are choosing only experienced people. So please try to get some extra certification like lifting operations, crane operations. And he said that if you are applying for jobs in, say, for a country like Abu Dhabi, then the certificates should be recognized by the industry of Abu Dhabi or the maritime industry of Abu Dhabi or the regulators of Abu Dhabi. Is that correct? Is that what you said?
Correct. Yeah, the best way to go forward is to find out someone who's working in Abu Dhabi or let's say in Australia and to know from him what all courses are required if I want to become a crane operator. Or let's say he's a crane operator already somewhere. He needs, there are Sparrow certificates. for crane operation. So he can have a Sparrow 3 certificate, and then he can go on board. Sparrows are generally ratified in all over the country, internationally recognized. It's just like STCW or IMO. So this is the way forward, because there are many courses in Mumbai and all over in the world, in India, which offer slinging crane operation course, but it might not be valid in that country they are applying or they are interested, that what goes with what. Indonesia doesn't accept anything, Malaysia doesn't accept anything being done in Western countries. So they would want their own institute. So it's like a lobbying thing as well.
Right.
So to have their own employment thing as well.
I think the best advice that you gave was that if you guys know someone who's already doing the job that you want, then better ask them, and they can guide you about the certification in the particular country where you are aiming to get that job. So it was good, very good advice. Captain, I think you have pretty much answered the next question, but this was asked as well, that what do you think are the advantages and disadvantages of working in oil rigs compared to the other ships? Now, of course, I think you have answered it to a larger extent, that salary is slightly better on oil rigs, but it's a more dangerous environment. Is there something you want to add in comparing like merchant fleet, cargo ships to DP vessels to oil rigs? Anything that, what is your point of view on that?
See, cargo ships and offshore ships, if you make a mistake, you have chances, and there are seniors to cover it up.
Hmm.
But in an oil rig, if you make a mistake, it could be your last one. You know, taking life in the factor. So that's why I emphasize that they generally take the HR over there, of the oil major, generally take experienced personnel who knows their job. So on that being said, on offshore vessels and the merchant ships, there is a particular task to do. You have to do every day, plan maintenance. It's all the same, only the advantage of being offshore in vessels are being, again, on which offshore vessel also, it is that you have a better, I think you have a better life. I have been in ships where I had better life, less contract, more money, good internet, a buffet of meals, which in merchant fleet you would not get. There is only one cook and one steward. Here you have I was in a diving ship, so I had total catering of 13 people and around handling 150-200 people, you know, total. So again, there is varieties of offshore vessels, like I said before. An anchor handler and a platform supply vessel would have 15 to 20 people only, just like a normal cargo ship, where there will be only one cook and one steward or something like that. So it depends on which ship you are. But yes, definitely you would feel an edge over commercial ships. Firstly, that regulatory implications are not there too much. because you are only in one port again and again and again. Your home port becomes one port. And secondly, you are comfortable with the environment. You know when you are signing off. You know when you are signing on. Your back-to-back would be probably a friend of yours. So these things, and you are every often you are coming to port having signals, you are working close to the port having signals, internet will be there most likely. There are companies which does not have internet still, but
so it actually comes down to also, of course, the type of offshore vessel you are on, also the type of the company that you are sailing with. So we are talking about it from, of course, captain's experience here, but you guys who are looking for jobs out there, maybe you want to make a shift from merchant fleet or cargo ships to offshore. It will depend also on the kind of company you're sailing with, who you're sailing with, the type of vessel you're sailing with. One of the advantages that Captain here mentioned that DP vessels enjoy is not to have regulatory implications. Captain, can you a little bit expand on that? What did you mean by that, that DP vessels do not have those kind of regulatory implications that normal cargo ships or merchant ships have?
Right. So with that, I would say in, let's say in a cargo ship, your garbage segregation is very, very strict. You are calling, let's say, port of USA, you will double sure, or will probably the chief mate will make someone responsible or super for supervision that every day garbage is segregated. You pinpoint on food waste to be thrown and all. So all that because you are afraid that if maybe a drone is seeing or a satellite is seeing, it is just, you know, that way. But here, nothing is thrown outside. Everything is put in one garbage tip, probably segregated.
Right.
And all you do is when you come back to port, or if some other vessel comes to collect that garbage, you put it in that ship. So this is one of the small examples. Second is for oil supply. You know, so if you are taking up from bunker ships, you have already have taken bunker two, three times or many times in that area before. So you are very comfortable. You know what is going to be, which papers to be signed, what implications are going to be applied. So every port has got their own set of rules and regulations and, you know, that what we exchange when we arrive to port in a commercial ship. So this is what I'm
talking about. Yeah. So DP vessels, of course, because they stay within one zone, one country, one port maybe, they are not subjected to those many regulatory implications that commercial vessels do. DP vessels, are they inspected by port state, flag state, or do they have audits and those annual surveys and all that? Do you have to go through all that as well?
It is all same, like in commercial vessels. Only thing is, because you are in one area, probably one that memorandum of understanding is only implied per year, or maybe if it has got a good rating in the database, they would not come for a year. Maybe they will skip a year and they will come next year.
Right.
And there is not much they can look in a very small vessel of 80 meters, 100 meters. You know, there is only limited. And nothing is changing because you are only in that kind of an area. So, unless there is an incident or accident or something else which has come up lately.
Right. Captain, thank you very much for clearing up the confusion that we have or the questions that we had on DP vessels and oil rigs and comparing it to merchant fleet. Just one question before we end the video. How easy is it to find jobs on oil rigs? Is it an easy shift or this is as much, it's very competitive as well to find jobs on oil rigs?
It is very, very competitive to find jobs in oil rigs. You have to be specialized. So oil rigs have got too many processes. So you will really have to talk to a specialized person, someone like who is in production of oil or gas. So there are oil extractors, you know, oil workers, they say, doing drilling operation. Then some people are in processing of oil, how they take out oil from the wells. That is another process. So that has got another team. Then you have seen the movie Deepwater Horizon. I think everybody will relate to that. So that was a oil drilling ship. But it is very similar to an oil rig.
Right.
So ships are generally used in places of where the depth is too much for a drilling setup or a rig to be installed, a platform to be installed. Because a lot of material expenditure is there. You have to make a big tower, you know, maybe 100 meters depth. So it is better to keep a drilling ship like Deepwater Horizon with many thrusters. That is a DP ship. So the girl you saw in that movie was a DPO.
Oh, I see. Okay.
And the girl, the supervisor, that person who was not very sure of his decision was the captain.
Right. I see. We are talking about the movie Deepwater Horizon. So for those of you who want to know more about oil rigs and the relationship with DP vessels, so captain here is referring to the movie Deepwater Horizon. Please watch that movie starring Mark Wahlberg, if I'm not wrong. And that provides a kind of insight into what happened actually on a real vessel called Deepwater Horizon and how it led to an accident and how can life be on oil rigs? Yes, Captain, please go on. So, about oil rigs and finding jobs on board.
So, I will just give a small explanation about what happened about joining. So, you saw the hero, not hero, he was the actor, everybody flew in with a chopper that day. That was their sign on. So like I said before, you know, it could be that you will have to join a ship on that. Then you will not get a very large cabin. Even for officers, they might have to share cabins. Okay. Because this is pre-planned, you cannot change the shape of the vessel or the accommodation, because it's a 10, 15 years old ship probably, you know, so you cannot change the accommodation. It is made for that. And the hierarchy of that is being the accommodation is also given as per your rank. So the boss there who was taking a bath and the explosion happened, I do forgot his name. So he's called an oil installation manager. And he has knowledge over a little bit of marine because of his experience. He doesn't have any marine related studies as such. But if you get into his educational qualifications, he's probably trained in, has a professional license in drilling oil related things. So there are many international courses, again, ICW and all, for drilling purpose. Similarly, there is many international courses for processing purpose, chemical related things. So, with reference to that, there are courses in UPES. Nothing to do with the college as such, but other courses, engineering, chemical engineering people can get into this line.
Right. As well.
So, what happened in that movie, right? So you see that DPO was in the bridge and the captain over there was also a part of the watch and he was in the bridge seeing things. So they didn't know much. Once they saw the flame and the fire, only then they started taking action.
In the drilling deck,
so that was the drill pipe which was going through a pre-existing drilling unit.
Right.
And they were trying to drill deeper and deeper. So the person who was forcing them to go deeper and deeper was the representative of the oil major, of the owner.
Okay, right.
The oil major. So he wanted oil, but then the oil OIM, the oil installation manager, wanted to say stop. I think it is not safe. But then because of pressures and all, he made a bad judgment and decision and he went ahead. And such a big mistake and massacre happened.
That's right.
So here everybody, so all when you see that person who is pushing the drill pipe is called the tool pusher.
Right.
The person who was inside that cage of control CCR.
Operations.
That guy is called a driller,
right.
You know, a drill control head or something like
right.
that. You know.
So I'll just clear it up for the viewers. So if you guys don't know what we're talking about here and why we're talking about it, so because if some of you have never been on offshore vessels or oil rigs, somebody like me, like I have never been there. So here, Captain is trying to tell you guys, if you want to visualize, if you want to understand, have an understanding of what all goes on there and who are the parties involved, the operations that goes on, then you must watch that movie Deepwater Horizon, because along with his talk, we are not playing any movie. So if he's talking about something, maybe you're not understanding. So that's why he's referring the movie to you guys and he's explaining the roles and the ranks and the parties involved. Also, this is very important for those of you who want to work on oil rigs, you want to find some employment. Captain here is trying to make it very clear that you don't have to be a seafarer to find work on oil rigs. You can actually find out about all the different parties involved, the different roles that are involved. He talked about mining, he talked about drilling, he talked about, you know, chemical experts. So you can take that route as well and get or find some job out there. So find out what really interests you and then you can do specialized courses, get some experience, and that would be a way to go about finding the job. Am I right, Captain? Did I summarize it correctly for the viewers?
Correct. Absolutely. One more option is there is as HSE. There is a course, I don't know if it is valid in Australia, but there is a counterpart for this thing is NABOSH. So NABOSH can be done and you can enter as a HSE, health and safety executive or safety officer or something like that.
Right. So there is another course called NEBOSH, and you can search it up online, NEBOSH, which is certifies you to become a health and safety executive. Did you say that?
Executive officer
or somebody. So more to do with occupational health and safety. So that is another route you can take to get a job on oil rigs. So this is why we are discussing, is that don't limit yourselves that only if I'm a seafarer, I can find a job there. You can be crane operators, you can be lifting experts, you can be chemical experts or drilling and all that thing. So many roles are there, and find the role that excites you the most, get your qualifications there, train yourself, and you might find a way to find employment on oil rigs. Captain, thank you very much for joining us today and providing with your experience. I'm sure no problem, sir. Some more questions. I know you are busy with sailing and you are finding some time for us. We really appreciate it. Captain, any last words of advice to a young mariners who are trying to find some jobs on either DP vessels or oil rigs? What would be your some tips for them?
I would say, if you get it, grab it. Don't look on, you know, a better deal. If you get it, just grab it in this point of time, and you will grow up the ladder as you find it.
So not to think about salary or contracts or anything. If you get an opportunity, just grab it. Is that what you would say?
That's right.
Yeah. So don't think of, so all you young boys out there who are trying to find jobs in DP vessels, do not compare your salaries with commercial ships or cargo ships or your friends. What Captain is saying, if you get the opportunity, grab it with both hands, get some experience under the belt, and then you can start worrying about either promotions or higher salaries. And that is the, I think, very valuable advice here, which I think young mariners should listen to. Thank you very much, Captain, and really appreciate your joining us here.
Thank you, Sam. Thank you very much. It's lovely to be on this platform again. Thank you.
Bye.